Hello people, in this video let us understand this terminology hypermetropia, something to do with the eye, right? Hypermetropia, that means the rays are going beyond the retina, right? So the image is forming where? Behind the retina. So this is the retina, right? So where is the image formed? Behind the retina. So this is hypermetropia. So basically this is a refractive error, okay? So what is it? It is a refractive error, and it is also called as hyperopia, no meter in the middle, right? So hyperopia, it is actually also called as long-sightedness, okay? But this is a misnomer. This is not actually long-sightedness. He is able to see far only because of accommodation, otherwise he cannot see far, okay? Can see far by using accommodation, but actually if he does not use accommodation, he cannot see what is far. Okay. So what is it? It is a type of ametropia. Now, in our refractive errors overall view, we have already seen what ametropia is. Ametropia is error, right? Some problem is there. That is ametropia, right? So in that you have myopia, hypermetropia, okay, and other things. But in this video, what are we trying to look at? We are looking at hypermetropia, hyperopia, long-sightedness. This is long-sightedness is not the correct word actually, because he can see long, but only because of accommodation. So you have understood the concept, right? So now what is this hyper? The image is going beyond the retina. Okay. So the image is getting formed where? Beyond, behind the retina, and that too for far object. For far object also, the image is getting formed behind the retina, hypermetropia. Okay, so at this is shown at when the accommodation is at rest. Okay, so look at the definition of hypermetropia. See the definition. This is a refractive error. Okay, parallel rays of light coming from infinity, even though they are coming from infinity, right? That is, even though they are coming from long distance, they are focused behind the retina when the accommodation is at rest. Okay. So this is what is important. So basically what is happening, if this is the eye, right? And from far the parallel rays are coming. These are images getting formed where? Behind the retina when the accommodation is at rest. But now this guy is saying, I have long sight. No, he doesn't have long sight. Actually, what is happening? Whenever he is trying to see far object, he is going to make his lens more circled, okay, instead of flat, more curved. So it will try to focus on the retina. So this is where he gets the name long sight. But actually, this long sight is only because of use of accommodation, and that too to some extent he can accommodate. If he has a major defect, even this won't help. Okay. So up to one diopter, guys, up to one diopter, he can accommodate easily and manage. Then with some straining of accommodation, he can see a little more. But let us say his power something like 5 diopter. Okay. His power is this. Okay. Can he see? Even with accommodation, he cannot see, right? Because accommodation is going to help him only with around one diopter. So now that the concept is clear, what do you think hypermetropia is? Long, can see up to one diopter. Okay. If there is one diopter error, he can manage with accommodation. Okay. And short, near things, far things, he can manage up to one diopter error with accommodation. Near, not really he can see, because he's when it's near, what happens? Let us say this is his eye, right? And it is near. Let us say the object is near. If the object is near, the rays are coming like this, so you need to converge them more, right? If you want to converge them more, you will try to accommodate. Whatever you try to do, you will try to converge them, but you cannot converge them so much. It will anyways go behind the retina. Okay. Hence, they use the term long-sightedness. Okay. So actually, he cannot see both. When accommodation is at rest, he cannot see both. So this is what you have to understand. When accommodation at rest, he cannot see, right? Basically, image is formed behind the retina, okay? Now look at this, guys. Let's try to understand this photo here. See, in all of these, the accommodation is at rest, okay? So the parallel rays coming from far for a normal person, where will it fall? On the retina. He doesn't have to strain his eyes at all. Now for a hypermetropic eye, the parallel rays coming from a large object and from a far object is falling where? Behind the retina. This is hypermetropia and the definition. Now how do you correct it? They give this person a convex lens. What does a convex lens do? A convex lens converges. It's a converging lens. So it will help him converge more so that the image will form where? On the retina and not behind. So the solution is what? Convex lens. Okay. So convex lens is what power? Positive power. Okay. Now that you've got the concept of hypermetropia, let us look at other things. Age and hypermetropia. Actually, when a baby is born, right, its eyeball is relatively short, okay? So, they are saying what? The eyeball is short. So, if the eyeball is short, what happens? The rays, they go and form behind the retina, okay? So, when a child is born, right, the eyeball is relatively short, so the image gets formed behind the retina. So it will be born with +2 or +3 hypermetropia. So a child has what? Hypermetropia. So can you imagine? The child has what they call as long-sightedness, but it is actually hypermetropia. This is gradually reduced. So around 5 to 7 years, they become emetropic. That means perfect. It will form on the retina. And up to 50 years, this person will remain emetropic. Okay. Again, after 50 years, this person will start getting hypermetropia. Okay. That is called as senile hypermetropia. Again, here they are telling it will be around +2 to +3. Same thing. Here also they have said +2 to +3, right? So now you understood the thing between age and hypermetropia, right? So that is where you should understand one terminology that is called as presbyopia. Okay. So in presbyopia, what happens? By age, this condition happens, presbyopia. So in presbyopia, actually what is happening? He is able to see far things. Okay. That is what you have to focus on. He's able to see far things. He's not able to see near objects like a newspaper or a mobile. That is because of accommodation. That is why they say presbyopia is an accommodation error. Right. But hyperopia is a refraction error. Okay. There's a lot more to cover. So let's continue. You have understood what presbyopia is, right? So you have to differentiate from it. Now, grading of hypermetropia, this is quite easy. Low is what? Low will be less than 2 diopter and high is greater than +5 diopter. Okay. Pretty simple, isn't it? In the middle, moderate, you can see. Clinical features. What will be the clinical features of these people? Mostly they will be asymptomatic. They will be using their accommodation and they will be trying to see the far things. Then they'll have asthenopic symptoms, that is eye strain, eye tiredness, or what else you can call it as. That is because they try to accommodate. Usually we use accommodation only to see the near things, but these people are using accommodation to see far things also. So in asthenopic symptoms, what and all you will have, not just eye strain, eye tiredness. These people can have tiredness of eyes, frontal or frontotemporal headache, watering, mild photophobia also they can have. And usually this will be associated with near work and evening. Towards the evening they will have such symptoms. Okay. Then coming to defective vision. So now this hypermetropia is quite huge, right? They cannot correct by voluntary accommodation. So what they will have, they will start having defective vision, which is more for near. So for the near objects, they will have more defective vision. That is why these people are called as long-sightedness, isn't it? So, are you able to understand? We are looking at the symptoms. Now, let us look at the Last one here, defective vision only. So now this person has hypermetropia is so high that he will give up. He will not even try to accommodate. So basically he will have defective vision for near and for distance. Okay. Then what else? Some of these people, they will go on using accommodation, and as age progresses, they cannot accommodate. Okay. So that becomes a manifest hypermetropia. That means these people had hypermetropia all the time, but now only it is showing. Why? Because these people were using accommodation all this while. So again, these people cannot see near or far. Let's look at the causes of hypermetropia, guys. Axial length. So axial length means what? Look at this image. So this is a emetropic eye. That means it's a normal eye, right? Let us say the axial length of this eyeball is less. This eyeball is only so much. Now what will happen? Automatically you can say the image is formed behind the retina. So this is what you saw even in the infant, right? So this is a very common thing, shortening of the eyeball. So 1 mm shortening, if it is there, then there will be 3 diopters of hypermetropia. Just 1 mm, 3 diopters of hypermetropia. Okay. That will be moderate hypermetropia, isn't it? Curvatural. So now if there is a flat lens or a flat cornea, what will happen? So they are saying a flatter lens or a flatter cornea. Okay. Now what happens? You have parallel rays coming from infinity. From far object, you have parallel rays. What will happen? These were supposed to get bent so that they can focus on the retina. But these are so flat, the lens or the cornea, they're so flat that these rays don't get bent. So what will happen if they don't get bent? They'll continue like this, and where will they go and meet? Somewhere much behind the retina. So that is why these people will have hypermetropia. So one of the causes will be curvature, which is less. There is flat cornea or flat lens. If 1 millimeter radius difference, it will result in 6 diopters of hypermetropia, even more. So curvature contributes to more amount of hypermetropia. But axial length one is the most common. Okay. Now what are we looking at? We are looking at the causes of hypermetropia. Now we looked at 2, axial length and curvature. Okay. Main things you have understood, right? Take a recap, guys. What are we looking at? The causes. The causes we saw, one is axial length. The eyeball is short, so the image is forming behind the retina. The other is the lens is flat or the cornea is flat, and the light rays are not getting bent enough, right? And the image is forming behind the retina. Now let us move on. Index. The refractive index of the lens, right, is less. If the refractive index of the lens is less, what will happen? Its power to bend the light is less. So light will not bend, it will go and fall behind the retina. Same concept, guys, did you understand? So the lens is not having good refractive power, so it is not able to bend the light. When the light does not bend, they are going to continue like this, and they are going to meet somewhere behind the retina. Okay, why does this happen? Why refractive index of the lens is becoming less? Because it is old age, it can happen when there is sclerosis of the cortex of the lens. Or if the person is a diabetic under treatment. So what will happen if this is the lens, right? The cortical sclerosis is happening. So the refractive index of the lens is reducing. Okay. So let's continue with the causes of hypermetropia. Just 2 more causes left. Positional and aphakia. So position of the lens. Okay. They're talking about the lens. So if the lens is posteriorly placed, right? The lens, instead of being placed here, if the position of the lens is not correct, then it can lead to hypermetropia. So what will happen if lens is behind posterior? It will bend here. So again, the light will go further beyond and form behind the retina. It can also happen that if the lens itself is absent, that is called as aphakia. So if lens itself is absent, only cornea has bent the light. So lens contribution is not there. So these rays are going to continue and form behind the retina. The image will form, right? So basically, aphakia and posterior subluxation of the lens. Okay, so both of these. So why can the lens be behind? Can be trauma also. Yes, now that you saw the causes, will you be able to say the signs that you will see in such people? So basically, what are the signs? It shouldn't be difficult. These are some things that you will see. So basically, what will you see? The eyeball will appear small. Yes, the axial length is less. So the eyeball will appear small. Okay. Cornea might be a smaller size. This is called as microcornea. So you should remember this term. Okay. The anterior chamber may be shallow. What do you mean by anterior chamber may be shallow? So where is the anterior chamber? Here they are cleanly marked it. Anterior chamber may be shallow. Why? Because the eyeball itself is, if it is small, it can happen that the anterior chamber is shallow, right? Then, fundus examination reveals small optic disc, right? So what will happen? This is where the fundus examination. So this is the fundus examination, let's say. So it will reveal that the optic disc is small, right? So it will look like papillitis, but it is pseudopapillitis, okay? And the retina will have something called as the short silk appearance. Short silk appearance. Remember, silk, short silk appearance. Why? Because the retina is closer to the examiner. So, it is looking brilliance, greater brilliance of light reflections in the fundus examination. So, what are they trying to say here? You're trying to examine this fundus. Okay, this is the fundus normal, right? But in this person, the axial length of the eye is less. So, the retina is somewhere here, right? So when you look at it, it will look bright and nice. So that is short silk appearance in hypermetropia. This can happen if the axial length is less, right? And then what else? When you see in ultrasonography, when you do biometry, that is measure, you will see that the anterior posterior length of the eyeball is short. Obviously, it will be short. Why? Because it is a small eyeball. So when you check the biometrics, the eyeball will seem smaller. Guys, just let us look at other things here. Let us say this is a normal eye, okay, and the rays are forming, the image is forming where? Here. Perfectly it is. This guy is perfect, okay. His eye is not hypermetropia. But what happens? There is retinal detachment. Retina itself comes forward. Then what will you say? Image is forming behind the retina. So retinal detachment guy also will have hypermetropia, that will be acquired axial hypermetropia. Okay, so we finished the signs, right? We saw biometry, measurement of eyeball, fundus examination, everything we saw. What else you saw in clinical features, the signs? You saw that the length of the eyeball is less, the fundus examination, you saw short silk appearance, pseudopapillitis. Then you saw that in when you do measurement of the axial length in ultrasound, you will see the short eyeball. What else did you see? Anterior chamber may be shallow, cornea may be small. Then you will see refractive error, that is when you do retinoscopy or autorefractometry, you can measure the amount of defect they have, right? Now you want to classify after doing clinical examination, you want to classify. So this person can have physiological. Okay, simply we'll put it off. Physiological, pathological. Two things we will learn of. Okay, severe physiological and pathological. Physiological or simple or developmental hypermetropia and pathological. In pathological, you have congenital causes and acquired causes. Then you have one more terminology, the third one, that is functional hypermetropia. That is because of third nerve palsy. Now, what is the simple developmental or physiological? Let's look at this one now. Basically, this is the commonest form. So, where and all did you see? Developmental. So, basically, you will see in this again two types, either axial or curvatural. Okay, two things you should remember as the cause, right? Axial or curvatural, the same thing will keep repeating under each of these types. Then coming to pathological. Let's move on to pathological. So, pathological. Now, where are we, guys? Here we are. Pathological. So, basically, because of conditions outside of normal biological variations. So let us look at this one now. Pathological. In that we are looking at congenital. Congenital, the person may be born with a small eye, micro-ophthalmos, nano-ophthalmos, microcornea. There can be posterior subluxation of lens. The lens has gone behind. That could be congenital. Congenital aphakia, the person is born without the lens. Wow. Now coming to acquired. Acquired, what and all can be there? Acquired can be senile. Again, we told you in this there are two types, not axial. Axial is not there under senile, but they have index and curvature. Index we saw, right, as old age progresses, there is sclerosis of the lens, right? So So the refractive index will reduce. So senile is index and curvature. And what is this curvature thing? Because the lens fibers, right, is reducing the curvature of the lens. Lens is becoming more flat. Positional, posterior subluxation of the lens, aphakia, congenital or acquired absence of lens. Consecutive hypermetropia, this is very interesting. Consecutive hypermetropia means the doctors went to treat myopia and they overcorrected it and the person now has hypermetropia. Wow. So what they do in myopia, they try to flatten this. So they over flatten it. Now it became even so much flat that the light rays is not getting bent properly. It's going directly where? Behind the retina. Okay. So that is what? Consecutive hypermetropia. Who caused this? The doctor trying to correct the myopia. Now the person has hypermetropia. Consecutive. Now acquired axial hypermetropia, we told you where the axis is appearing reduced because of retinal detachment. What else can be there here? Acquired axial hypermetropia. You can have central serous retinopathy, orbital tumors. Always blame some tumors here and there. Then acquired curvatural hypermetropia. Now why, what happened curvature, what is happening? Because of some infection, inflammation, trauma, the cornea became flat. Pseudophakic hypermetropia. What is pseudophakic hypermetropia? See, when you give a person, what is phakia? Phakia means lens, right? It's the crystalline lens. Aphakia. Aphakia when the person does not have a lens. What is pseudophakia? You give him a false lens, that is an intraocular lens, right? An artificial lens. So this lens, the way they have given it to that person, it is giving him now hypermetropia. The power of the lens is not so compatible. So we looked at what and all, physiological, then pathological. Okay, now lastly, they have a functional hypermetropia, third nerve palsy, that is the oculomotor nerve, right? That's the third cranial nerve. Actually, we should write like this, cranial nerve 3, that is oculomotor, right? Nerve palsy. So movement of the eye is affected. So these people will have paralysis of accommodation. Okay, internal ophthalmoplegia. So accommodation is affected in these people. So isn't it refractive error problem? Then why did they include that here? Anyways, so we are done with what? The types of, clinical types of hypermetropia. Types means there are so many ways of classification. Look at this. Total hypermetropia. Total means when accommodation is at rest. This is by the definition. When accommodation at rest, the parallel rays form image behind the retina. So that thing is the total hypermetropia. By using accommodation, he is able to correct some amount of it. That is latent hypermetropia up to 1 diopter. Now, there is something called as manifest. Okay. So under that you have facultative and absolute. Facultative means he is able to put some effort, okay, strain and look at the image. That becomes facultative. And absolute is where there is some amount of hypermetropia which cannot be corrected by whatever he does. No accommodation is going to help with that. So that is why when they do eye checkup to check for hypermetropia, they have to give drops, eye drops, which will stop accommodation. Then only they can come to know the total hypermetropia. So these eye drops they have to put before the eye checkup. Cycloplegic, cycloplegia. What do they normally use, guys? You can remember cyclopentolate. Short acting, cyclopentolate, etc. Long acting, they can use atropine. So what happens if we don't give treatment? So it can, these people will keep on rubbing their eyes, right? And introducing lot of infection. So they can get styes, that is external hordeolum, right? Then the inflammation of the eyelids, blepharitis, chalazion is actually not infective, but chalazion also they can cause, okay? So by rubbing their eyes. These people may get something called as an accommodative convergent squint in children, okay? So this can happen in children, usually by the age of 2 to 3, because they will start using accommodation a lot, okay? Then amblyopia. What is this amblyopia? So they are telling there can be anisometric amblyopia in unilateral hypermetropia and strabismic amblyopia in children developing accommodative squint. The same thing what they have mentioned here. Okay. Or they can be ametropic amblyopia. okay, seen in children with uncorrected bilateral hypermetropia. So let us try to understand this. So there is a child. So let us say one eye has hypermetropia. Okay. So what will happen? One eye's image is forming behind the retina. Only one eye's image is forming behind the retina. So what will happen? This person will develop anisometropic amblyopia. That's, this becomes the lazy eye. The other eye is perfect, let's say. So this, the development of the vision, right, in the central nervous system happens only from one eye. So this will become anisometropic amblyopia. Okay, then predisposition to primary narrow angle glaucoma. So these people are predisposed to glaucoma. So you should understand, right? What is glaucoma? Optic nerve damage could be because of raised intraocular pressure. Because they have shallow anterior chamber, we already told you. So as age progresses, the lens of size of lens is also increasing. So what is happening here? Anterior chamber was already shallow. Lens is growing with age. So this person's pressure will increase. As the pressure increases, this guy will develop glaucoma, right? Remember, with age, what is happening? The lens is getting bigger. So that is why in elderly, you should not put mydriatics. You should be very careful while giving mydriatics. Okay, lastly, we have reached the treatment of hypermetropia. You already know you should give convex lens. What do convex lens do? They have positive power. They converge the rays, right? So that they can form exactly on the retina. Okay. So you can give these convex lens in the form of spectacles or contact lens. So there are a lot of things with this. If this person also has astigmatism, how to correct, etc. So remember convex lens. So basically spherical it will be, right? Spherical lens. And you should gradually increase, you know, the power so that the person can accept the manifest hypermetropia. There are some rules here, like if there is accommodated convergent squint, then full cycloplegic correction should be given at first sitting. And if there's amblyopia, then you should give full correction with occlusion therapy, right? For amblyopia, they will try to occlude the good eye so that the lazy eye starts working and learning. Okay, now let's move on. This is optical treatment. What else is there? Surgical treatment, basically it's the same thing, guys. You have cornea-based procedure, lens-based procedure. Cornea, what and all you will do? Some keratoplasty is there. LASIK, that is laser in situ keratomeleusis. It is called as hyperopic LASIK. And they have hyperopic PRK, that is photorefractive keratectomy. For lens, what and all they can do? So if there is aphakia, they'll give a lens, right? They will give a artificial lens, or they can remove the existing lens and put an artificial lens, right? What else? Implantable contact lens, etc., etc. That's all about hypermetropia, guys. Let's close this video. Hypermetropia, we saw what the definition is. Parallel rays will form image behind the retina when the accommodation is at rest. It is called as long-sightedness because the person can use his accommodation to see some amount, okay? And it's also called as hyperopia. So what is this? So this is the definition. So we understood how he is able to see far because of slight accommodation. He can see up to one diopter, okay, because of accommodation. Okay, so this is normal eye, this is a hypermetropic eye, and that is a corrected eye with convex lens. Age and hypermetropia, we saw when a child is born, it is hypermetropic. Grading, low is less than plus 2, high is greater than plus 5. Clinical features, we saw the symptoms, asymptomatic, asthenopic symptoms, defective vision with asthenopic symptoms, and just defective vision. The signs, you will see that the eyeball may be small, cornea may be small, anterior chamber is shallow. Then you have, you will see there is hypermetropic refractive error, fundus examination, pseudopapillitis, short silk appearance, and ultrasonography will show short eyeball. Anteroposterior length will be short. We saw the causes, mainly axial length, curvature will be flat or index will be less, पोजिशन ऑफ द लेंस, एफेक या नो लेंस। क्लिनिकल टाइप्स वी सॉ फिजियोलॉजिकल एंड पैथोलॉजिकल एंड देन फंक्शनल दैट इज थर्ड नर्व पैल्सी। कॉम्पोनेंट्स ऑफ हाइपरमेट्रोपिया वी सॉ टोटल लेटेंट मैनिफेस्ट फैकल्टेटिव एब्सोल्यूट। कॉम्प्लिकेशंस बिकॉज ऑफ रबिंग ऑफ आईज, स्टाइस, ब्लेफेराइटिस, चिलाजियन, स्क्विंट दैट इज अकोमोडेटिव कन्वर्जेंट स्क्विंट, यू शुड टेल दिस अकोमोडेटिव कन्वर्जेंट स्क्विंट, एम्ब्लायोपिया। दे आर प्रीडिस्पोज्ड टू डेवलपिंग ग्लॉकोमा। ऑप्टिकल ट्रीटमेंट विद कॉन्वेक्स लेंस प्लस पावर इम्पॉर्टेंट इन दैट यू हैव कैन गिव स्पेक्टिकल्स और कॉन्टैक्ट लेंस। सर्जिकल यू हैव कॉर्निया बेस्ड प्रोसीजर्स, लेंस बेस्ड प्रोसीजर्स। कॉर्निया विल बी केराटोप्लास्टी, केराटेक्टमी, लेजर इनसीटू केराटोमिलियोसिस। ओके, व्हाट एल्स? दैट्स ऑल फॉर नाउ इन दिस वीडियो। बाय बाय।